Hi, everyone. My name is Alexander Adamov. I'm happy to see you here. Thank you for voting for my talk. I didn't expect that someone from OpenStack community is interested in cyber attacks. So good for me. So who I am? I'm from Mirantis. I've been working for antivirus companies for last 10 years. I've been analyzing malware, investigating security incidents, and finally I come to cloud security. And here today I'm going to give you introduction on targeted cyber attacks from a threat analysis standpoint. We've talked on Monday about IDS system, about deployment, but today we are going to talk about threats actually. So what all security things in OpenStack actually are made for. I'm going to talk about three issues. First one is like general overview of most popular targeted attacks, or APT. I'm going to explain what APT is. Detection approaches, and finally we come to intrusion detection system. So what targeted attacks is and what APT? So previously targeted attacks were made using backdoors. It's just simply a simple malicious program that connects to server, steal something, send to the attacker. But now backdoors, they get complicated. So backdoor is not enough anymore. So usually targeted attacks made using some program software complex. So it has a module structure, and it depends on chosen victim. So here I can see the main scheme how targeted attacks is actually done. We can see attacker that sends a phishing mail, or it can be watering hole attacks when the attacker just hijacked websites, put some malicious inclusion on the website. And the employees from the company doesn't get a trick, and social engineering trick, open attachment or visit the infected website, and finally employee's machine gets infected. Once infected, the backdoor is installed, and backdoor actually allows attackers to communicate with the victim's machine to harvest necessary information, send it to the remote server. And also, in case of targeted attacks, single victim is not the main purpose. Actually, once infected, the attackers, they try to scan the local network and proliferate through the corporate network to find like really valuable targets like servers, database servers, whatever. All harvested data then upload to the attacker command and control server. As you can see, targeted attacks are made through four ways. Is a spear phishing attack, just when you send email to some particular victim, you know exactly who this victim is, and you even know which what language victim speaks. Watering hole attack is when you know what kind of websites a victim used to visit. So once you know, you can hijack one of these websites, and the next day victim opens these websites, he or she gets infected. Exploits, zero-day exploits are very effective, but they cost a lot. So that's why they're done using not actually zero-day exploit, but already discovered and patched exploits. And of course, backdoor. This is not online war game. It's good infographics by Kaspersky Lab. You can see APTs, Advanced Persistent Threats, discovered recently. The length of the ship shows how long this APT has been in operation since the discovery date. So if you're interested, you can go to the APT logbook at securelist.com. So it's quite interesting. You can see like many of them have been discovered during the last several years, but the trick that the majority of them were in operation much more time before. So like for 10 years, possible. This is the example, first example, Epic Turtle attack discovered in 2014. And it uses many techniques, pair phishing with attachment, with PDF attachment that implements PDF exploits, social engineering techniques, sending STR file. STR stands for screensaver, but it's just usual executable file in Windows. Watering hole attacks. Here I can see example of the watering hole attacks. The victim was actually a Palestinian embassy, and they hijacked the website of Authority Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Palestine. So that sounds reasonable. It makes sense. And they you can see the malicious inclusions is JavaScript. Once you open this web page, you fell down a victim of drive-by attack. And the next one is a fake Flash player, like this one. Has anybody installed such fake Flash player? Nobody? OK. So it looks pretty much like the original one. The next APT is Cloud Atlas, discovered in 2014. The interesting thing that legal cloud provider, which called CloudMe, was actually not the victim, but it participated in the attacker scheme. So the storage was used to store stolen data and send this data to the attacker. So it was like like a Dropbox, so you can put stolen data. You can see like recorded audio files, which came from victims. And after that, the attacker can log in and download all the data saved on this account. By the way, the account, the analysts, they were able to get into the account just analyzing the file. They figure out the login and password embedded inside of the backdoor. It's actually not the first time when the public cloud providers are used to deliver malware or to use in targeted attacks. We discovered 2 years ago when three botnets, RBot, BlazeBot, and EnergyBot, they used Dropbox to deliver malicious files. Before putting the malicious samples into the Dropbox, attackers, they use polymorphic encryption just to avoid being detected on cloud provider side, and then just distribute the URL to the victims, and the victim get uploaded these new malicious samples to machines. As you can see, it worked well, but later Dropbox increased the security policy, and now it's almost not used. Another one, Carbonac, is a banking APT. It's the biggest bank robbery. Carbonac attacked more than 100 banks, mostly in Russia and the United States. And the total loss of all banks amounted to $1 billion. The interesting thing that once penetrated the bank network, they recorded activity of the employee on the screen. Then they ripped the video and sent to the CNC server. And after that, the attackers, they watch the video, they get figure out how it works, how to make transaction in this particular bank, in this particular information system. And then they just do the same, send money to ATM machines, and then someone grab the cash from ATM machines. That's interesting, you can read it. It's very fun. It comes as a VBS script. It was rather big, 2 megabytes. And on board, it has 3 exploits. They are not zero day, actually. Communication, of course, the communication comes through HTTP, and all data were encrypted using RC2 and Base64. As you can see, the majority of malware and, of course, target attacks, they use encryption for traffic. So we can't figure out what is inside of the traffic, of the malicious traffic. And you can see the examples of a request. You can see the embedded part is actually Base64. Yeah, this is just fun. This is some notice for employees, for bank employees, how to detect if your machine is infected. It's for Windows machines. It's a map of targets. As I said, the top targets are Russia and the United States. The interesting thing that targeted attacks, they use remote administration tool, and they used penetration tools and hacking tools. Once backdoor installed on the victim machines, it is capable to connect to the CNC server and the request to download some hacking tool to the victim machine. Among them, you can see the RAT Metasploit. I think there is no sense to describe what Metasploit is. PSExit is a tool by Mark Rusinovich. It's the simple implementation of Telnet protocol. Mimikatz is also a hacking tool to get a login password in Windows operation system. Another one, actually the family of Dukes. Cosmic Duke, Onion Duke, and Cozy Duke is the latest threat discovered last month. Supposedly, those malicious programs were written by Russian developers. And here you can see quite impressive list of spy features. And this is the dumps where you can find, for example, where we found the files, the type of files they were looking for. So you can see like it's documents, presentation, pictures, and this is the social networking accounts they are trying to steal credentials for. Just geography, you can see the Russia is actually the most target country, but probably the attackers, they target some diplomatic and government institution in this area, and also United States. As well, we can see hacking tools found on CNC servers. So that actually fits our hypothesis about the functionality of the APT. So backdoor connects to command and control server and tells, okay, give me please some hacking tool, for example, vulnerability scanner, yep, like Joom scan or whatever, or brute force tool. I have for you a little demo about Cozy Duke. It's also from Duke family. It is famous because of attacking White House and US State Department. It comes as zip archive in attachment. Once you open this attachment, you can see some executable file. It's a flash video. As you can see, this flash video is about funny office monkeys. By the way, another title for this thread is Office Monkeys. I think you should heard about this attack because, media made a fuss about this because, among the victims, as I said, were like high-profile targets like White House and U.S. departments. So, what's the point of showing this video to victims? So probably, of course, first one is taking your attention away. You're looking at this video and something is happening in your system. But now we don't see any suspicious activity. I mean, we don't see, for example, any network communication. You can see a Wireshark sniffer. We can see any network communication. But in Process Explorer, we can see only process for Flash Player. So that was made. So there is a sleep. So this application sleeps for 2 minutes. It was made just to avoid, for example, being analyzed on automation solutions like sandboxes and whatever. And of course, when employee opens this file, so he or she sees nothing. But after 2 minutes, we see some strange process started. And after 2 minutes more, we see some, you know, strange activity is going on. As you can see, the data sent through HTTP is actually base 64 encoded. We can open, we can follow the stream. The main point of this presentation is to find out the network indicators of compromise, so how we can detect such attacks based on network traffic. Here you can see the flow, the traffic flow, and we can find out the server, San Jose Maristas, and some data, base64 encoded, sent to the attacker. It's some kind of, you know, request sent to the attacker's server. Then we can, for example, open a registry editor, and we see update the outrun section, and we can find out that there is some extra value in this section. And this section actually is responsible for running this program once your system boot ups. In Linux, backdoors, they write themselves into crontab, just to be executable from time to time. When we open the reference folder, we can find files. All files are digitally signed. However, the root is not trusted. It's just, you know, another social engineering trick when the victim sees that file is signed, so it looks like okay. Okay, that's all. Let's continue with our presentation. And the next section is about a communication protocol. Long story short, after analysis of this encrypted data sent to the server, we figure out that the data was encrypted using RC4, and over RC4 we have base64. Just reverse engineering opening the file in disassembler, we can figure out that the algorithm ID, then we can figure out, okay, the key, because the key is exported in the memory. So you can see this is the RC4 key, it is 16 bytes. And then after that, we can figure out that this key actually embedded into the header of network of the network packet in HTTP packet. So it's easy how you can, for example, by reverse engineering, you can crack the communication protocol and understand what is going on. Moreover, configuration file is also encrypted, and you can use the same RC4 key that you can found in the memory or in the header of the file. And it's XML. In XML, you can see server's XML section. It contains two servers, two command and control servers. One is primary, second is like, you know, backup. All of them are legitimate. They were just hijacked. Malicious web server was set up, and it's used to send the commands to the backdoor. So the main conclusion for APT is that communication with command control server is always encrypted and compressed. Unfortunately, we cannot hack it or crack it on the fly. And also, it's interesting that the majority of target attacks use remote administration tool or penetration testing tool. So about detection approaches. As you know, there are two approaches, signature-based and anomaly-based. For signature-based, we can use, for example, URLs that we, for example, figure out from the configuration file. Also, we can use some IDS signatures triggered to traffic. We can use domain names of command and server, command and control servers. Anomaly-based. So we are looking for some anomalies in network traffic. Unfortunately, backdoors, they use the same HTTP protocol as, you know, as all other applications, web applications. So it doesn't work. We can come to clustering. Despite its quite, you know, resource-consuming theme, it still doesn't work because we have a high level of noise. The clustering approach is about, you know, finding similar packets, put it in one cluster, And if some packet doesn't fit any cluster, so it goes to a new cluster. But you know, there are a lot of packets that goes to a new cluster that doesn't work. Detection of URLs. As you know, there are some networks, like you know, suspicious networks. One of them is called Russian Business Network, and it has you know like some particular set of IP addresses. So we find out in your network there are some these IP addresses. So your RDS system will trigger this alert, like known Russian Business Network IP group. Next one, you can analyze URLs like this. For example, this is a URL to download some backdoor. Okay, if you see it, the registration country is Ukraine, actually my motherland. The lifetime of the domain is 1 year, which is you know, which fits for phishing URLs. They use the register short time URLs. Register is Russian one, also suspicious. Content type undefined. Finally, you have a penalty points, so this URL really is not cool. Don't open it. APT use hacking tools. Here you can see the list. It's based on these four APT analyzed today. So, summary. It's okay to use signature-based approach, but the problem is we have some delay between the discovery of the signature and applying the signature to your cloud, to your network. Anomaly-based doesn't need a signature, so it works like you know in a proactive way. But you know, it's hard to apply to APT because when you know governments they organize targeted attacks, they do not create you know short time URL domains. They hijack existed domains, which are, you know, looks pretty trusted. So finally, we come to IDS. How we can use IDS? So I recommend using Snort or Suricata. So both of them support so-called emergency threats rule sets. So those rule sets, they are free. You can apply it for your IDS system. As you can see, the rules are grouped into some sections. For example, some rules are grouped in malware, some in bot command and control servers, some of them to Tor traffic to detect. So your goal is to find the trade-off between you know, performance and coverage, detection coverage. So for example, you don't need to enable, for example, mobile malware if you have no access from BYOD. Or you do not expect any Tor traffic, whatever. This is an example of IDS rules for APT based on previous examples. So we can use this one. You can also check if your IDS can detect the following hacking tool. Unfortunately, in default, in free version of emergency threat rule set, not all of them are presented. So you have to check it. If it's not, you probably should take ET Pro. It's more advanced rule set. It covers more threads. It has more signatures, but it's not for free. And of course, you can create your own. You can add a rule to your IDS, following, for example, blogs of antivirus vendors. So they usually publish network indicators of compromise. You can grab it and apply it to your IDS. Incidents response model. So here we have, for example, you build the cloud. You build the private cloud. Of course, you should use some infrastructure provider to get hardware, access to internet, and so on. Usually, infrastructure provider is responsible for any abuse reports. For example, if someone from your private cloud connects to, you know, command and control server or to Tor network, so your cloud, your infrastructure provider will notify you about it. Also, if someone, for example, runs you know, some spam attack or phishing attack, so it's almost the case. But you sometimes you don't know, okay, what particular solution is used by your infrastructure provider, because infrastructure provider just give you it as a service. So you don't know what is inside, what solution is used. You can enforce your private cloud with your own security service. For example, if you sell the service to some company that wants, some special security policy to comply. So, and they say, okay, we need you guarantee us some security level. So you can install, for example, IDS and enforce the security level of your cloud. For example, for banks, this Carbonac is the first criminal APT. And if you want, for example, to attract banks to move from on-premise facilities to the cloud, so you need to guarantee, okay, we guarantee that Carbonac case won't happen for you. And so you should show some facts how you're going to do this. So my proposal is you can use IDS and you can use fresh rule sets. You can adapt the network indicators compromise published by antivirus vendors. What we have now in OpenStack? Unfortunately, IDS is not integrated yet in OpenStack. What we use in Mirantis, we use Fuel plugins to automatically deploy IDS. Because, for example, if you need to deploy IDS in some small cloud, you cannot do by hands. But if you need to deploy IDS, for example, for 200, 500 nodes, so it's not possible. So we can use Fuel plugins to deploy IDS in an automated way. It's done through Puppets. You can find actually the detailed guideline how to create this plugin for Fuel. So as you have seen, targeted attacks can be detected by network indicators of compromise. Like we figure out for OfficeMonkey's case, we can, for example, detect it by two servers, which I used to connect. But those two are not the only one. So you can go to antivirus company blog and you can find out more command and control servers. Also, IDS need to be properly configured. It's not the end of the story when you deploy IDS. You need to take care about it. You need to supply it with new rules. You need to add some new indicators for compromise because threats they come out like every day, every hour, and that's why they call zero day. So you need to react very fast. You need to get these indicators, for example, from if you don't have your own security department, your security researchers, you may just follow the antivirus blog. So they usually publish it very, very fast. So that's all from my side. Thank you for your attention and welcome for questions. Yeah, probably you're welcome to use mic.
Hi, Mariano Cugnetti from Enter Cloud Suite. We run a public cloud. My question is, where do you think is the best place to install an IDS in a public cloud? I mean, the discussion is whether to place it inside a tenant, inside the private LAN, on the router, at the provider's level. What do you think about it?
It depends. It depends on, of course, on the size of your cloud. But typically, it is recommended to deploy IDS on compute node. So it is going to be tenant targeted. So you can with one IDS target one tenant. But if tenant has many nodes, so probably you need to install IDS on every node. Also, I like the idea presented by Dan Lambright about allocating separate node, like monitoring node where you can install IDS, IPS, whatever. Because IDS is quite resource consuming thing.
That's why I was asking why you would install it on compute nodes. If you install it on compute nodes, then the providers is in charge of administering them. If you provide it in the tenant or maybe on the router or a tap as a service, then you can charge the user for this resource-consuming service.
Yeah, from this point of view, it's a good idea.
So you say that having IDS on compute nodes is best suiting for private clouds and on the router for public.
No, it's cloud. Existed solution. Like what is recommended, but it's not the only one.
Okay, thank you.
Could you talk a little more about your IDS configuration? It sounds like you're talking about running it not inside the tenant, you know, as a VM, as part of the tenant network, but on the outside, sniffing the traffic.
Yep. You can, as I said, you can install it on a compute node. You can set it up to listen to some to public interface to intercept the available traffic. My point is to pay attention to configuration rule sets. So it's very important because there is no sense to enable all rule sets from emergency threads because it will cost you a fortune. So it's important to find out what threads do you expect in your cloud and then enable rules for that.
Well, in a lot of network configuration, or in a lot of Neutron configurations, I mean, you might be using GRE tunnels and things mm-hmm. like that. Does your IDS have, if you're running your IDS on the hypervisor itself, doesn't really have visibility then to all those things, right?
Yep, I agree.
Okay.
Any more?
How do you get the IDS?
Can you please use mic?
I'm just wondering, how are you normally tapping the traffic to the IDS?
You can, as I said, you can install it on compute node and just listen to eavesdrop the public network. But it depends on architecture, so it's not the case for big clouds. So you right. should consider your architecture, your size of the cloud. I'm not actually have a lot of experience in deployment in big clouds, but I have more experience mostly in configuration with rule sets.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.